turn their street on. Singing their song, as the choir did, but coming to his presence on holy ground.
Amen.
It made me think of the wise men and the magi as they went to visit the baby Jesus, and how reverent they were to be in his presence and to be able to worship him and praise him. What a wonderful opportunity they had. And then we come today into the sanctuary that we might also reverence him this morning. For we surely do come and stand on holy ground. We welcome you this morning if you are visiting with us, and we pray that your visit will be very meaningful and that you will fall in love with Former Memorial Baptist Church and the people of this church. By way of announcement, you can look at your bulletin, and also in the middle of the bulletin, we have our goal for Lottie Moon, which is $3,000. We have given to date $1,420, and if we exceed that, would be a marvelous thing. And then you can see that on Tuesday, December the 12th, we have a finance committee meeting at 4 o'clock. Finance committee meeting. All of you on the committee. And so, December the 19th, we're going to have a special Christmas presentation. And then Brother Al and the choir. And then I'll have the blessed privilege of reading some scripture and commenting on that. Thank you, all of you, for the Christmas dinner yesterday afternoon. And thank you, Brother Carl, for calling me and reminding me not to forget. And then Sunday, December the 26th, we will be observing the Lord's Supper. Friday, December the 31st, New Year's Eve fellowship. Bring your favorite soup and stew to share. Oh, I get to cook something. All right. And then the poinsettias for the sanctuary is $10 to donate in memory of or honor of someone. And so you can see that. And then last week's bulletin insert and questionnaire that you can write down what you desire in a pastor. And so the committee is going to begin working, and you be in much prayer for them as they pray to be led of God to the man that's going to become your pastor here at the Former Memorial Baptist Church. And, I would like to thank you myself and my wife and I for your call to minister to you during these days. And may the Lord bless you. We want to remember all of those who are sick and suffering on the prayer list. There was many mentioned in the Sunday school class this morning. So all of those that were on the board, that are put on the board, and I think some of the Huff family, Tyler Harmon, Christy, I got some of them, but we want to go to the Lord in prayer and remember all that are sick and suffering, those that have lost loved ones. And would you bow with us, please, as we approach the throne of grace this morning. Father, Truly, it is a privilege, a blessed privilege to be able, Lord, to come and to talk to you. And Lord, you told us in the Word that we are to pray and let our requests be made known. We thank you for the Holy Spirit, Lord, that is our helper. Lord, that he takes our prayers when we really don't know how to pray. But Lord, we say what's on our hearts and in our minds, and we come, Father, this morning thanking you that the Holy Spirit takes our prayers and brings them before your throne of grace, and Lord, makes them presentable, Lord, to you. Father, we praise you this morning. We thank you for the blessings that you bestow upon us. We thank you, Father, that you kept everyone safe last evening during the storm that came our way. And Lord, we were able to get home safe. Thank you. Bless your holy name. And Lord, we're mindful of those that on our prayer list that are sick and suffering, some dealing with various diseases. Lord, I want to thank you, Lord, for my voice. And Lord, how you have made it strong once again, that I may be able to preach the unsearchable riches of your precious word. Father, for those that are in the nursing homes, we ask, Lord, that you bless them this morning. Lord, may they, Lord, rejoice and be glad in this day that they still can move and have their being. And pray that you'll give them a good day. Pray, Lord, that they will rejoice, Lord, if they are able to receive and hear the word. Those that are home, Lord, homebound, we lift them up to you and ask you, Lord, to be with them and bless them. There may be some traveling today, Lord. I don't know, but I pray that you give them, Lord, journey mercies and keep that protective hedge about them. Lord, those that have lost loved ones, we pray, Lord, that you would be with them and that comfort them. And Father, that the Word says, Lord, that when we go through those times of losing a loved one, Lord, we know that that time is going to it's going to take time to have healing, and Lord, to be able to look to you for strength and for guidance, for peace in our hearts and minds. And Lord, to be able to just keep on keeping on until you call us home. We ask, Father, that you would be with those men and women in uniform, wherever they may be today. Those that are in authority over us, from the White House on down, we lift them up to you, Father, and pray that, Lord, that they would look to you for wisdom and knowledge and guidance, Lord, as they rule over such a great people in this nation we call America. We thank you, Father, for the privilege of being born here, and Lord, maybe some were not, but they are citizens of the United States of America, and that they too will thank you and rejoice for the freedom that we have in this country, Lord, today. We pray, Father, Lord, that you would just be with all of the staff in the church here in Fulman, and Lord, that you would bless in this service today, and the Holy Spirit of God would take control and move in a mighty way. Lord, we desire to see great mighty things take place in this church. Be with the search committee, Lord, as they are going to begin to reach out, as they have resumes coming in, and seek out a man of God, Lord, as you are going to send to this church. May your will be done, Lord, in that area, and then also in the service today. We love you. Thank you for loving us, and we pray, Father, that, Lord, that you just move now and have have your way in this service. In Christ's name, amen.
If y'all will stand and turn to hymn number 294, singing One Day. We'll sing the first, third, and fifth verses of One Day this morning.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men by example is seen, living in light.
men to come down, please. All the men, come down. May we go to the Lord in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we, the men of this church, have gathered together here before the altar. And Father, we come this morning and we thank you, Lord, for these men are the leaders of this church, Homer Memorial Baptist. And Father, they're the ones that will go forth and lead this church into the future. I pray thy blessings upon each and every one of them, Father. I pray, Lord, that they would look to you for wisdom and knowledge and guidance, Lord, from this day forth, that you would anoint them afresh and anew this morning, Lord. Fill them with your Holy Spirit. And, Lord, may they be strengthened and built up, Lord, in the faith and the inner man. And, Lord, may they use their intellect. May they use their talents. And Lord, their will be in your perfect hands. May they be in your perfect will for the future of this church. We ask thy blessings to be upon them, anoint them with your Holy Spirit. Once again, I pray, bless them now, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Take your Bible, if you will, this morning, and turn to the book of Matthew. Book of Matthew, we'll be looking at that in just a moment. But I want to talk to you this morning about the birth of the King. So we find in the first chapter of the book of Matthew, we have the revelation of the King. He reveals himself to the Jews, to his person, his principles, and his power. And so I want you to look with me in chapter 1, verse 1, as we'll see some of his genealogy there. First of all, before we do that, let's look at verse 18 down through verse 25 of Matthew chapter 1. And it says that the birth of Jesus was as follows. After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, not wanting to make her a public example, was minded to put her away secretly or privately. But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. So all of this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us. Then Joseph, being aroused from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him, and took to him his wife, and did not know her till she had brought forth her firstborn son. He called his name Jesus. I want you to note with me, first of all this morning, the faithful providence of God. And so we see in verse 1 of Matthew chapter 1. The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham begot Isaac. Isaac begot Jacob. Jacob begot Judah and his brothers. Judah begot Perez and Zerah by Tamar. Perez begot Hezron, and Hezron begot Ram. Ram begot Amminadab, and Amminadab begot Nahshon. Nahshon begot Solomon. Solomon begot Boaz by Rahab. Boaz begot Obed by Ruth. Obed begot Jesse. And Jesse begot David the king. David the king begot Solomon by her who had been the wife of Uriah. Solomon begot Rehoboam. Rehoboam begot Ahijah. Ahijah begot Asa. Asa begot Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat begot Jerome. Jerome begot Uzziah. Uzziah begot Jonathan. Jonathan begot Ahaz. Ahaz begot Hezekiah. And so on and on. And so providence is God's control of all the circumstances so that his will prevails in spite of the disobedience of men. God's will continue to prevail. So I want you to think of Satan's attacks against Israel and how he sought to prevent Christ from coming into the world. And all down through history, the Jews have been attacked. Because of Abraham's disobedience, Sarah was almost lost, and the promised seed ruined. Almost lost, and the promised seed ruined. I want you to go with me to the book of Genesis and chapter 12. Book of Genesis, chapter 12, if you will. And we're going to read some scripture there in verses 10 through 20. And it says, now there was a famine in the land, and Abram went down to Egypt to dwell there, for the famine was severe in the land. And it came to pass when he was close to entering Egypt that he said to Sarah his wife, indeed I know that thou you are a woman of beautiful countenance. My, she must have been something special. I think mine is, don't you? Therefore it will happen when the Egyptians see you, they will say, this is his wife. And they will kill me, but they will let you live. Please say you are my sister. So here we are. False truth. Or as we have learned today, half-truths. Please say you are my sister, that it may be well with me for your sake, that I may live because of you. Because if they think that you're my wife and they want you, they're going to kill me. So it was when Abram came into Egypt that the Egyptians saw the woman, and she was very beautiful. The princes of Pharaoh also saw her and commended her to Pharaoh. And the woman was taken to Pharaoh's house. And he treated Abram well for her sake. He had sheep, oxen, male donkeys, male and female servants, female donkeys and camels. But the Lord plagued Pharaoh And Pharaoh called Abram and said, "What is this that you have done to me? Why did you not tell me that she was your wife? Why did you perpetrate a lie?" is what he said. "Why did you say she is my sister, that I might have taken her as my wife? Now therefore, here is your wife. Take her and get out of here. Go your way." So Pharaoh commended his men concerning him, and they sent him away and his wife and all that he had. Then I want you to go with me over to 2 Kings, if you will. 2 Kings, chapter 12. Almost lost the lineage. At one time, Israel's seed was all slain except for one, for young Joash. So I want you to look with me in 2 Kings chapter 12, verse 1. "And in the seventh year, Jehu, Joash became king. He reigned 40 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Zebiah of Beersheba. And so if it hasn't been for Joash, the seed, the lineage, would have been broken." You can also go over to 2 Chronicles, if you will. 2 Chronicles. And you can see there, 24:1, you can find that about Joash. This genealogy is not a dull list of names. You know, when you're reading the Bible and you come to they begot, and even most preachers skip over begot. But it's a record of the faithfulness of God. How God was faithful in keeping the lineage going in order that the king might be born one day. It is a record of the faithfulness of God in preserving the children of Abraham as a channel through whom Christ would come into the world. And you can imagine in your mind all the length of time from Abraham to Jesus and what all transpired, what these people went through. You take life in general. One day you're on the mountain, and then the next day you might be in the valley. One day, it's all praise and honor and glory and health and wealth. And then all of a sudden, something tragic takes place. Some difficulty, some disease, some catastrophe. Some tornado. Some storm. And life changes. And so Abraham had his ups and downs, and all down through the lineage, there was good times and bad times. But God was working all the time, preserving that lineage in order that the blessed Son of God would come into this world one day. That it would come out of Abraham's lineage through, so Christ could come into the world. Matthew's genealogy is of Joseph. Jesus came through Joseph's genealogy. natural father, human father in the eyes of the law. Luke gives Mary's genealogy, and both were descendants of David. Both of them were descendants of David. So we have the second thing, the fulfilled promise of God. And so you see there in Matthew 1, and you can look in, with me in verses 18 through 25, as we read that earlier. And you can see how the birth of Jesus was as follows, and Mary was betrothed to Joseph. Before they came together, she was found with child. They were engaged. It's fast the law being engaged among the Jews was as binding as marriage itself. Today we get engaged, but we're not married. But under their law, it was considered, it was a done deal. Just as if they had already said their vows, already made that commitment to become one with each other, to leave their father and their mother and be joined together. But when Joseph discovered, and I've seen some young ladies in my life that they have kept themselves in such a manner where just before birth did they begin to show. And I've seen some out here like this. And so, or some carry them in the back. You know, so. God bless them. And anyway. But Joseph, looking at Mary, and here she is going to have a child. Can you imagine when he discovers her condition? And he assumes that, watch that word assume. She's been unfaithful. Can you imagine the thoughts that's running through his mind? And in that day in which they lived, he was going to be made fun of, laughed at, scoffed at. She's going to be ridiculed. The Bible says, while he thought on these things. Let me ask you a question, guys. What would you think? What would you do? I probably would have said, you got another thing coming if you think I'm going to marry you. I think that we'd be thinking probably along the lines of Joseph. But how important is it to be slow to wrath? Don't be so quick to make a judgment. And we are prone to make quick judgments. People can commit a sin and or fall, go short, make a mistake, and we're quick to judge. And only by the grace of Almighty God can we discern and decide the right way instead of the wrong way. I want you to go with me over to Deuteronomy. chapter 22. Deuteronomy chapter 22. Chapter 22. To consider the way she looked. Here she was about 16 years old. And the thoughts begin to run through your mind. What are people going to say? What are people going to say when you and I sin? What are they going to say about that? What would we do this morning if we found out that someone in the church had committed a sin that we consider unforgivable, and there's no sin unforgivable, but yet when we judge, when we judge to the point to where we would just break fellowship? Or when we look at the big picture of things and realize that we sin too. Judge not that you be not judged. And so here's Joseph. He's caught between the rock and the hard place. So I want you to look with me in Proverbs 22, Deuteronomy 22 and verses, chapter 22 and verse 20.
Circumstances, and I just
had those dreams quite often. But sometimes dreams are so real. And have you ever, you're having a dream and it's something good and you wake up and it just breaks off. And I want to go back and finish that dream. See what the end is. Well, here's Joseph. And God spoke to him in a dream. In order to listen to God in that dream that he sent to Joseph, he had to have great faith. But not only that, but tremendous love for Mary. His love for her. Made him willing to bear reproach. To bear reproach. Listen. Christ fulfills the prophecy of Isaiah, chapter 7. And we can go over there to the book of Isaiah, chapter 7. And I want you to read with me Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 14. Therefore, verse 14, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The Lord himself. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. God himself. In the Bible, there are only four ways for a mother to have a baby. Only four ways. First of all, she can have a baby without a man. They can have a baby without a man. There can be a baby born without a man or a woman. As Adam did. Adam was made from the dust of the earth. Was he not? God just took the dust and formed him. And the Bible said, and he breathed into his nostrils. And he became a living soul that is. So a child can be brought into this world without a woman or a man. The second thing, with a man, but no woman. As Eve was taken from Adam's side, a rib. Can you imagine? And then the third, with a man and a woman as being a woman, as children are born today, with a man and a woman. And in the fourth thing, with a woman but no man, as Jesus was born of the Holy Spirit. Four ways that a child in the Bible can be brought into the world. It's important, or it was important, that Jesus Christ be born of a virgin. Be born of a virgin. That he might have a sinless life. That he might be a sinless human being. Have a sinless nature. conceived by the Holy Spirit. And so you can go with me over to Luke's Gospel, chapter 1 and verse 26. Luke. Chapter 1. And it says, in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city called of Galilee named Nazareth. Verse 27. To a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. By the Holy Ghost. Only Jesus Christ could come into this world to be born of a virgin because he existed before the creation of man. As we read in our Sunday school lesson this morning, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the same was in the beginning with God, and without him was not anything made. How could he ever be born of a human father and a human mother if he was going to be the sinless Son of God? Look with me, if you will, Matthew chapter 2. Matthew chapter 2.
Treasures. They presented gifts to him,
gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Then being divinely warned in a dream, they departed for their own country another way. Now then, when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, "Arise, take the young child and his mother, flee to Egypt, and stay there until I bring you word. For Herod will seek the young child to destroy him." When he arose, he took the young child and his mother by night and departed from Egypt, and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, "Out of Egypt I called my son." Out of Egypt, God preserved the lineage, and God saw fit to bring his son into this world to be born of a virgin, so that he might save us from our sins. We rejoice today at the birth of our Savior and our Lord Jesus Christ. And so he stands today to receive you into his arms, because he came and was born of a virgin and went to the cross of Calvary, suffered, bled, and died on that tree for your sins and mine and the sins of all mankind. And if you're here today and you're not saved, today's the day of salvation. Now is the accepted time. Now is the time for you to receive Christ into your life, that you might place your hand in the nail-scarred hands of Jesus, that he might love you and forgive you of all your sins and all your trespasses. And if you're here today and you have become cold and indifferent through some kind of sin in your own life, now's the time that you can come to the altar and claim 1 John 1:9, which says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness, and he'll restore us back to the fellowship that we once had. Every head bowed, every eye closed, no one looking around, every Christian praying, "Father, the King has come. We have looked at the birth of the King and how he came into this world to be born of a virgin, to live a sinless life. Only he, the blessed Son of God, could do that. Without spot, without blemish, and willingly gave himself to suffer the reproach of mankind, to be laughed at, scoffed at, spit upon, beaten, nailed to a cross, had a spear thrust into his side where the water and the blood ran out of his side, down to the ground. And the song says, "What shall wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What shall make me whole again? Nothing by the blood of Jesus." My friend, my brother, my sister, that Jesus washed away your blood, of your sins through his blood? Are your sins under the blood this morning? Because only the blood can cleanse the sin that you and I commit. I pray that everything's well with your soul this morning, but if not, we're going to give you an opportunity to make things right this morning. Father, as we stand in a minute, we pray your will be done in this invitation. Pray the Holy Spirit will draw those that need to be saved, if there's one, and for those that need to come and rededicate, recommit, draw them this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand? Privilege to be here with you. May God bless you. Robert, would you dismiss us, please?